Hello learners, I welcome you all to this video session where I will be discussing the theories of development and behavior. So in the human growth and development course, which is basically a foundation course of psychology, we have seen that how psychological concepts are important for social workers. Therefore, in this session, we will discuss what is the process of socialization of a child, of a human being, and then how the personality of an individual develops through various stages. We will discuss Freud's psychosexual theory and Erikson's psychosocial theory. And also we will look into the three constructs of the personality development from the psychoanalytic perspective of Sigmund Freud. We will discuss the different coping mechanisms that are important in the human behavior, and then how due to different conflicts, inner conflicts, if the conflicts are not resolved, they can give rise to certain antisocial or dysfunctional behavior within the individual personality. So let us see what is actually meant by the process of socialization. Socialization is a continuous process where individuals interact within the members of the society. They interact with others and share it. It enhances sharing of experiences, communication, and these communication develop meanings. The meanings found in particular experiences may be expanded through the process of socialization. When a person moves out of that environment or into another social environment, so here social environment means the surrounding that we live in, and the socialization process continues. There are various adaptive behaviors, that is adjustmental techniques that are used, and one learns through these experiences of interacting with the other members of the society. They learn about other person's culture, whether it is similar or different from them, and it helps in building up their personality. The psychosexual and psychosocial theories imply that there is a struggle within an individual and as the stages develop. So in the different stages of development from his or her birth, in the stages, certain inner conflicts develop. And accepting the realities of life, dealing with each abstract and particular conflicts that develop in our psyche during the course of development, it is important to actually form a healthy personality in the individual. The sources of socialization are firstly the family, because that is when the baby directly comes into contact first with the family members, the mother, the father, and then the extended family, the siblings. So all are important in the socialization process of the child. Peers and friends, and that is the group outside the family that they are living in. Community here also includes the neighborhood, the relatives, okay, who maybe live in and around and who are in contact, in constant social visits. So it advances the process of socialization. And then through media, different types of media, electronic media, print media, and then also the regional and national culture where a child is growing up enhances the socialization process. For example, if the child who is of Indian origin but born and brought up in another foreign country, then that particular culture will have a lot of influence in the socialization process of the child. Now moving on to Freud's psychoanalytic perspective, that gives us an understanding of actually how individual's personality develops. In order to survive and cope in society, individuals have implicitly developed ego defense mechanisms. So here, ego defense mechanism, now we'll see firstly the concept of ego and superego. In the psychoanalytic theory, Freud has talked about the different constructs of a personality. It is said that id is the core of a personality as it is believed to be present and fully functional at birth. It basically signifies or symbolizes the basic instincts or the basic needs that the that require that demands it demands immediate gratification of that particular need. It remains in the unconscious mind and plays a role in the development of unacceptable urges and desires and memories, because these are not rationalized at that particular point of time when the child is born. They may not be possible to implement in real life as the person grows. That id is always present in the person. But then we'll see going to ego and superego. But let us discuss this concept of id. The expression of these basic urges and desires is based on hedonistic and pleasurable principles which may not be rationalized or accept socially acceptable. Then comes the role of ego. In superego, first let us see what is superego. In contradiction to the concept of id, superego is conceptualized as the center of moral standards, or it holds it closely holds to the moral conscience of an individual. Suppose the id demands an immediate gratification of a need. Superego is the moral conscience that says that, wait, you have to first look into these things. It checks whether the various ways of satisfying id impulses are right or wrong. Therefore, the superego sees that whether the id demand is socially acceptable or not. Ego plays a very important role. Ego acts as a reality checker for the id. Ego helps to meet the needs and wishes of id, but by creating a connection between id and reality. So basically, ego is guided by the principle of reality and mostly resides in the conscious level. That brings a balance. The ego aspect brings the balance between the id and the superego. Now, moving on to this defense mechanism. As we have seen in the previous part, that ego plays an important role in defending the certain actions by that is demanded by the id and then superseded by the superego. And ego brings out a balance between the immediate demand and the moral conscience. So now let us see how these coping mechanisms or defense mechanism of a human being function. These are the types. Repression. This technique is used unconsciously to keep away disturbing or threatening thoughts occurring in the mind. Suppose a person has committed a particular action which is not socially acceptable. That person will try to not think about it and then try to divert the attention so that the person is not disturbed or does not create any anxiety within himself, so that individual knows what he or she has done. And in order to deal with anxiety, the person will divert the attention or will not think about what he or she has done. This technique is used unconsciously to keep away disturbing or threatening thoughts occurring in the mind. So that is the first way how a person deals or they defends his particular actions. Then we go to projection. It is a technique through which individuals make others responsible for their own thoughts, feelings and motives. So what this person does who has who thinks that he or she has committed a socially unacceptable action, he or she will try to make others responsible for their particular action that they have done. And that is how they try to defend what they have done. And that is how they try to actually not have the guilt feeling or the anxiety which they would be living with. Now, displacement. This is a technique which most of us, we must have seen maybe in our own family members or friends, that when a person is angry or is aggressive over someone else, and that is directed to another victim. So basically, displacement is the redirection of an impulse onto a powerless person or a target, which serves as a symbolic substitute for the person object causing the actual aggression. For example, you have a very dominating supervisor or a boss at your workplace. And when you go home, you vent out that particular frustration or the aggression that you have been victimized with on another member, maybe your sibling or maybe your spouse, you let out your anger and frustration on that person. And that person on whom you let out your anger or frustration is actually will be the victim of your anger on someone else. So that is why it is known as that it is a redirection of your impulse or aggression onto a powerless substitute. Okay, so sublimation, another technique. It is similar to displacement. But the emotional outburst that is caused to you because of any kind of disturbance or anxiety caused by another individual, it is let out through the form of maybe art, music, okay, or in other constructive way, not a destructive way. When you let out your anger on another person who is innocent and who is actually not the cause of your real anxiety or anger, then you form a destructive activity. But when you let out your frustration or vent out your anger on in another way, maybe through some creativity, maybe through art, or maybe through music, then it is known as sublimation. It is a constructive way of letting out your, or it is a positive defense mechanism. Denial. Suppose that person knows that he has done something wrong. Denial involves blocking external events, facts, or knowledge from awareness by refusing to experience them. For example, an alcoholic might always be in the denial stage that he has become completely addicted to alcohol. So here the person uses the technique of denial. The person completely denies that he or she is an alcoholic and will give various kinds of excuses that this much amount is not alcoholism, or this is not leading towards alcoholism, and things like that. So denial is a technique not to accept the reality. So that is also a defense mechanism. Regression. Individuals respond to a threatening situation in the way which is appropriate to their earlier age and level of development. For example, a student who has failed in an examination, maybe due to not studying or not submitting all the assignments in time. And then what the student does is to defend himself or herself, goes to the teacher and tries to plead to the teacher to make him pass, or plead to the teacher that he should be promoted, and starts crying. So that method is known as regression. It is appropriate to the role and is appropriate to the age that the individual is going through. And rationalization. It is the cognitive distortion of facts to make an event or an event less impulse and threatening. So here rationalization means showing reasons to validate what you have done. So basically, if you have done something unacceptable, you will show various reasons or try to create a scenario in your mind that what you have done was actually right. So that is known as rationalization. And reaction formation, lastly, this is where the person behaves or reacts in a way where the opposite, actually the person wants to react in another way. So socially he has to show that he has not done anything wrong, and therefore his reaction will be like, he will give explanation and try to show a different picture. That is known as, instead of reacting in a particular way, in an apologetic way, the person will be more defensive about what he has done. That is known as reaction. The reaction will be opposite to actually what the person is thinking. So these are the types of defense mechanism that we see in a human personality. Now going to Erikson's psychosocial theory. In Erikson's psychosocial theory, he has talked about different stages of development, in which he has said that there are various conflicts that take place within an individual personality. If these conflicts are not dealt with in a proper way, then it leads to certain behavioral issues in the next development phase. So in the next slide, we will see the different, that 8 distinct stages of development. So he developed this theory in 1959, and it assumes that a psychological conflict occurs within the inner, an inner conflict occurs at different stages of development, and there are different needs of an individual, and these needs will create conflict, inner conflict in the mind of the individual. And these conflicts need to be settled, or these needs to be dealt with at that particular stage of development, so that the individual can move on to the next development stage. According to this theory, successful completion of each stage of development is important to develop a healthy personality. And if these conflicts are not resolved, it will lead to disturbance, it will lead to an antisocial behavior maybe, and it will also lead to certain frustration. And this may result in the development of more unhealthy personality, sense of self, the impact of different social roles like parents, schools, friends, teachers, office colleagues, then spouses play a distinct role in the life stages, which shapes the personality of an individual from childhood to adulthood. These are the different stages: infancy, early childhood, preschool, school age, adolescence, young adulthood, middle adulthood, and then maturity. So you can have a look at this particular table, which is also there in your electronic ESLM, which is uploaded in our website. But here in the chart, you can see that the basic conflicts that are stated here are in the infancy stage, trust versus mistrust. That is, the child develop a sense of trust from the caregiver, that is the mother. And if the care is lacking at this stage, it will lead to mistrust. That means the child will develop a personality where he or she will not be able to trust anyone. Therefore, feeding is an important activity by the mother, which creates the trust factor. Early childhood. Here, autonomy versus shame and doubt. The child has to be empowered to make his own decisions. Sometimes too much controlling by the parent at this stage will lead to shame and doubt in his own abilities. Therefore, it is important to give some amount of independence and autonomy to the child. Preschool. Initiative versus guilt. The child needs to begin asserting control and power over the environment, that is the social environment in which he is living. Success in this stage leads to sense of purpose, and child who try to exert too much power experience disapproval, result in a sense of guilt. And in the school age, there is the child is working hard. In the new social environment, there are academic demands, and success leads to they with a sense of competence, while failure results in feeling of inferiority. Therefore, the child is in competition with his peers, and it boosts up his personality if the child is working hard and achieving his goals. Otherwise, it will lead to some kind of inferiority complex. Then we come to the adolescent stage, which is also a very confusing stage. A child or the adolescent is always confused whether he is to be treated as an adult or a child. So the teens needs to develop a sense of self, then personal identity, and then success leads to ability to stay true to himself, while failure leads to confusion and a weak sense of self. So it will build confidence in the teenager, the adolescent, so that he or she can successfully move to the next stage, that is young adulthood. So young adults need to form intimate and loving relationships, which is automatically formed in most cases, and success leads to strong relationships in future, while failure leads to idleness and isolation. So the person will also develop inferiority complex and isolation if he or she is not able to have any intimacy with the person of another gender or maybe the same gender. So therefore, they need to develop relationships of different kinds. So coming to the stage of middle LRO, we will see the generativity versus stagnation. The person needs to develop from by procreating things and individuals which will outlast them. So here basically means procreation of children, looking after them, and being busy with the children, and then or the work or the career that they are involved in. It leads to a sense of satisfaction if these needs are met, and then work and parenthood form the main focus of this particular age group that ranges from 40 to 65 years of age. Failure or conflict in this stage leads to a sense of shallowness and less involvement in the worldly activities. And then moving on to the maturity stage, here ego integrity versus despair. At this age, the person looks back into his or her life and should have a feeling of fulfillment. And success at this stage leads to feeling of wisdom and maturity to accept the reality of death, while failure results in regret until death is confronted. Therefore, at this stage, one has to actually look back into the things that he or she has done and maybe feel proud about it and satisfied about it, or might have certain regrets about the life activities that he had been involved in. So these are the 8 stages of development as put forth by Erikson, and he has talked about how the basic conflict between these 2-3 elements. It is important to resolve these conflicts, because only then it will lead to a successful proceeding to the next stage of development. And now let us move into another important theory, which is Sigmund Freud's psychosexual theory. According to this, the famous psychologist Sigmund Freud talked about the personality of an individual starts developing from his birth, it keeps changing until the later stages of one's life. Freud identified 5 childhood stages in which there is development of personality through a theory which is known as psychosexual theory. It says that the psychosexual energy of a child is the driving force behind his or her personality development. So Freud relates the different developmental stages of personality to the sexual desires which are in the subconscious or conscious level in the person's psyche. A child encounters particular conflicts in each of the stages, and these conflicts must be resolved before the child can successfully advance to the next stage. Now let us see the different stages put forth by Freud. He has talked about the oral stage, and it is the first stage of personality development where the baby's pleasure seeking activity is directed through the mouth. So since Freud relates this development of personality and development of actually the person's life through the different unconscious and conscious sexual activities and urges in the infant stage, it is seen that the oral stage or the gratification of the sexual need is basically through the baby's mouth. Freud said that too much of oral stimulation can lead to oral fixation, and a person can develop problems like smoking, nail biting, finger chewing, and thumb sucking more. So such habits become more prominent at times of stress. So if this stage, if the sexual needs are not met in the form of maybe breastfeeding or any other form of oral sexual urge, then it is seen that it can lead to certain bad habits or addiction in the particular person. In the anal stage, that is 1-3 years, a child develops to control his or her bodily functions through toilet training. The anal stage asserts that in this particular stage, the child learns to control the bodily urges, and toilet training is an important aspect, yes. But if the parent is too controlling or you know at this particular stage, it may lead to certain negative personality in the particular child. For example, a child may develop less confidence, or the child may have problem in decision making. So at this stage, though toilet training and other controlling activities are important on the part of the parent, this needs to be restricted also to some extent. The phallic stage. During this stage, a child unknowingly struggles with his or her sexual desires towards the opposite sex or opposite sex parent. For example, boys are unconsciously physically attracted to the mothers, and girls are attracted to the fathers. It is not about only physical attraction, it is also physical plus the personality attraction towards the opposite gender in the parents too. So this was a very contradictory state of statement made by Freud during that age of time, where he first developed this psychosexual theory, because it talked about Oedipus complex, Electra complex. In Oedipus complex, it is said that the mother, the boy is attracted to the mother and the girls are attracted to the father. So that is how it is said that unknowingly or unconsciously the child may be attracted to the parent of the opposite gender. A boy child is attracted towards his mother and sees his father as a competitor for the mother's attention. This is known as Oedipus complex. A girl's desire for her father's attention, wish to take her mom's place, and is known as Electra complex, a term coined by Carl Jung. He is another psychologist. Latency. During this stage, implicit sexual feelings subside and the superego or conscience begins to develop in a child. So here the child is conscious about the sexual urges, but the superego or the moral conscience try to control the basic or instinct of the particular child. The child begins to develop moral values by adopting some of their parents and other important adults' behavior. So here the child's superego actually comes in way of immediate gratification of the needs demanded by the id. And here ego also balances the rationality of the id and the superego. In the genital stage, where you see that it starts from age of 12, that is the onset of teenage, during this stage, explicit sexual urges reemerge, where it is no more an unconscious or something to be hidden about, and there are explicit sexual urges that reemerge. In other stages, if these are successfully met, adolescents engage in appropriate sexual behavior, and that is said to be a healthy one. So instead of repressing all these various sexual desires, it is seen that starting from the oral age, anal age, phallic, then latency and genital, the sexual urge is always there, and it is in the form of either unconscious or the conscious state of mind. Therefore, Freud has termed this theory as the psychosocial theory. The word psycho means of the mind, and the sexual urges that are always there, it is either in the inactive or the active form of our conscious mind. So that is all. And so here today we have seen that how in the development of personality, these stages are important, and where this inner conflict and urges needs to be fulfilled for a positive personality formation and socialization process is also important here. So today we have discussed the different types of coping mechanisms, and then development of personality and the theories of personality, and how these conflicts are important to be resolved for a good personality formation. So thank you so much, and hope you have understood the different concepts in relation to theories of behavior.